In the aftermath of the Watergate scandal, a new political crisis was forming on the other side of the planet. On one side, 59-year-old Edward Gough Whitlam, a man who had completely redefined the Labour Party and brought them out of their longest political drought, and was now completely redefining Australia as Prime Minister. On the other side, 45-year-old John Malcolm Fraser, the recently elected sixth leader of the Liberal Party, who had used his political influence to stifle the government and force a political deadlock. And between these two would be the recently appointed Governor-General of Australia, 61-year-old Sir John Robert Kerr, a former Chief Justice from New South Wales. What would unfold in 1975 would go down in infamy as one of the most controversial moments in Australian political history, in which people on all sides of government have their opinions on the choices made and their outcomes. As for me, I will attempt to cover this story as apolitically as possible, as we look into the election of 1975.
Well, may we say, God save the Queen. Because nothing will save the Governor-General.
In 1974, Whitlam and his Labour Party defied the odds to win the double dissolution election, and thus a second term as Prime Minister, with only a slightly reduced majority in the lower house. Meanwhile, the Senate remained divided, with both parties holding 29 seats each, with two independents holding the balance of power, those being Michael Townley and former South Australian Premier Steele Hall. Despite holding on to power and eliminating his Democratic Labour Party rivals out of Canberra, Whitlam still found himself at odds with the upper house when it came round to passing the same bills which had triggered the 1974 double dissolution election. As a result, Whitlam had no other choice but to call the first and to date only joint sitting of Parliament, as per described in the Constitution. This would involve both the upper and lower house sitting as a single legislative body to resolve all withstanding bills. Despite having a minority in the Senate, Whitlam's numbers in the lower house more than made up for it, giving the party a 95-seat majority in the sitting compared to the 92 held by all other parties. As a result, Whitlam was successful in passing all six of his bills, which saw the creation of Medibank, today's Medicare, as well as some electoral reforms including the establishment of two senators for both the Northern and Capital Territories. It was also around this time that Sir Paul Hustluck's term as Governor-General came to an end. Whitlam had offered to extend his term, however, Hustluck declined, citing that his wife did not wish to stay any longer at Government House. As a result, Whitlam had to appoint a new Governor-General to replace Hustluck. After his initial choice for Governor failed, Whitlam would offer the position to one Sir John Kerr, the current Chief Justice of New South Wales. Whitlam and Kerr did not know each other very well. However, Kerr was close friends with other members of Whitlam's government, and both their wives had studied together at school. Whitlam had hoped the former Chief Justice would be a respected choice as Governor-General, and, with Kerr being a former Labour member, a man sympathetic to Labour's agenda. However, what Whitlam did not know is that Kerr's political views had changed, and, what Whitlam would soon find out, the two saw the role of Governor-General quite differently. Despite successfully getting his bills and governor picks through Parliament, Whitlam would find himself governing Australia through one of its most challenging periods since World War II. In 1973, the nation of Israel would find its existence under threat when it was attacked on two fronts by the Islamic nations of Egypt and Syria. Western nations such as the US were strong allies of Israel and would send massive amounts of military support. This greatly aggravated the oil-producing Arab nations who supported Egypt and Syria, and in response, these nations would begin a months-long oil embargo which saw the global supply of oil drop drastically, triggering an energy crisis. Almost overnight, the price of fuel would spike, along with it all other goods, as oil was used in production and transportation. In turn, this would lead to the biggest recession since the Great Depression, and soon Whitlam's government found inflation and unemployment rising rapidly. Despite this, Whitlam would still push for a wage increase in the public sector, as well as increased spendings on education. This led to great unease within the Labour Party, which would result in Whitlam's deputy Lance Barnard being replaced by Jim Carnes. Despite the economic troubles, Whitlam would still proceed with giving Papua New Guinea its independence as well as crafting the Aboriginal Land Right Act, which ought to give a large amount of the Northern Territory over to the Aboriginal people there as a protected region from outside mining and farming operations. Due to finances being hard to come by, for Whitlam to fund his more ambitious development projects, he would have to seek out a loan. The standard practice was to conduct the loan through the Loans Council, a group consisting of a member from each state, territory and federal governments, who oversee financial borrowing of all the governments. However, in 1974, the coalition dominated the states and territories' governments 5-3, giving them control over the Loans Council, making them very hostile to any borrowing by Labour, especially in a recession. To avoid the council, Energy Minister Rex Connor attempted to get a loan through a secret channel with help from a Pakistani banker by the name of Taras Kemlani. This whole action was against precedent, as not only was Connor acting independent of the Loans Council, he was also acting independent of the Treasury as well, and the use of Arab sources was quite unreliable and risky compared to the safer US and European finances. The loan would never eventuate, and Whitlam would end up securing the loan through a US investment bank the next year. However, the original loan details would leak out, and despite the loan never actually being conducted, the Whitlam government would be attacked viciously over the shady dealings, and later, when it was found out that Connor was still dealing with Kemlani, Whitlam would be forced to sack him. All the loan had resulted in was portraying Labour as incompetent, and its polls would tank. With the polls increasingly showing the Labour government as unelectable, the new leader of the coalition would yet again try and force another early election. Since losing the 1974 election, the knives had been out for Billy Snedden. Despite Labour's woes, Snedden was unable to make headway against the charismatic Whitlam. This would eventually lead to his demise at the hands of the conservative wing of the Liberal Party, led by one John Malcolm Fraser. Fraser was born in Melbourne in 1930 and had grown up in a very politically active family, with his father heavily being involved with the Liberals back when they were the United Australia Party, and his grandfather being one of the very first members of the Australian Senate as a member for the Protectionist Party. After studying overseas, Fraser would return to Australia and would win the seat of Wannon off Labour, who have never held the seat since. During the 60s, Fraser would move up the ranks of the party and would become Minister for the Army, in which Fraser would oversee the controversial Vietnam conscription program before being moved to Minister for Education and Science when Gorton took over. Gorton would move Fraser yet again, this time to Minister of Defence, right at the height of the Vietnam protests, which made Fraser's job very difficult. Eventually, Fraser would resign from his position after disagreements with Gorton, and would assist in Gorton's downfall, a move which Gorton never forgave Fraser for, right up until his death in 2002. After the coalition's downfall in 1972, Fraser would have to fight to keep a position in the shadow cabinet, and would eventually end up with the Minister of Industry Relations. However, after Snedden's defeat in 1974, he would make his move to take over the Liberal Party, failing initially in 1974, but succeeding the next year. Shortly before Fraser took over as Liberal leader, Tasmanian Independent Senator Michael Townley would join the Liberal Party, giving them 30 out of the total 60 seats in the Senate, giving them effective control of the chamber. This control was strengthened even more when Queensland Labour Senator Bertie Milner died in June. Due to his death, it fell upon the Premier of that state to replace him. However, instead of going with Labour's pick of Mal Colston, Queensland Premier Joe Bjelke-Petersen would instead send Albert Field, a Labour member who was a massive critic of Whitlam. This outrageous move would immediately be challenged in court by the Labour Party. However, in the meantime, Labour would be down a man in the Senate. Seizing on his Senate majority and Labour's unpopularity, Fraser would use the Senate to create a political deadlock in Canberra, hoping yet again to force Whitlam into another double dissolution election. However, with polls increasingly showing a landslide defeat for the Labour Party, Whitlam would not call the election, and thus the 1975 Australian constitutional crisis had begun, with the government unable to pass any bills. This would put a countdown in Canberra, as without a supply bill, the government would run out of money and go bankrupt. One of the two men had to yield, but who would it be? Come back next time for part 2 of the election of 1975.